Today on Bits, we're going to talk about silicone. So what is silicone? Well, it's not silicon. Silicon is an element on the periodic table that's often used in making computer chips. But when you add carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen to silicon, you end up with a polymer that's silicone. Silicones are great for all sorts of personal and commercial uses because they are non-conductive, they're easy to clean, they're non-toxic, and basically nothing sticks to silicone, which makes them great for mold making. You've seen us use silicones for mold making as well as making a work mat. This is great because it's super easy to clean off and non-conductive for electrical projects. Now, silicones come in a variety of viscosities, different thicknesses for different purposes. That viscosity has a lot to do with the molecular weight of the particular silicone that you're talking about. Sometimes that can be a stretchable plastic, or it can be almost a liquid. Something like Rain-X has a really low molecular weight, so that's basically something that you can spray onto a surface. The molecular weight of the silicone affects the flexibility and the hardness of the material itself, and this is called the Shor hardness. It's basically a durability scale. This is measured by taking a piece of metal and pushing it into the plastic, and based on how far it will leave an indentation gives you the Shor hardness. This is a little bit of a harder thing to explain because it's not a single scale from squishy to rigid. It's actually a number range, but then there's multiple ranges that overlap based on the type of material that you're talking about. When you're shopping for silicones, it can be really confusing to figure out what you need based on the product name. Oftentimes you will see a proprietary product name and then a letter and a number combination. The product name, like Moldstar, is just made up by the manufacturer, and it really means nothing. That letter and number name is probably what you should focus on because it typically will indicate the Shor hardness. Like I mentioned before, Shor hardness is a set of overlapping scales, each one with its own range. Now, the beginning of that is going to be 00, or A, or B, or C, or D, and then there's a number right after that that indicates the point on that particular scale. So, for example, you may have a 0030, and then you may also have an A30 and a B30, but those are not the same hardness. For example, recently we made some silicone work mats, and the first one was way too flexible. It was a 0030. So then we used an A30 silicone to make the other one, and it was a lot more rigid. Like I said, they are a set of overlapping scales that don't all start at the same place. Another thing to remember is that those numbers do not indicate anything about the curing time or the pot life of the material. And if you see a T at the end of the product name, that probably just means that it's tintable. So as far as choosing which Shor hardness you need for your project, you really want to think about what you're going to be casting. If you have really delicate parts that you need to mold, you want your mold material to be super flexible so that you don't break your parts. But if your casting is not so delicate, you can use a much harder mold that will end up lasting a lot longer. When you're mixing silicone, you're typically taking two parts, mixing them together, and starting a curing process. And there are two major types of silicone mixtures, tin and platinum. Now, this is the base metal that's used in the curing process. Each one of these mixtures has its own benefits and its own weaknesses. First, let's talk about tin cured silicones. These are typically less expensive, they're resistant to heat, they release easily, and they react better to objects that have sulfur in them. But a couple of the downsides are that the silicone is more likely to tear and has a shorter library life after it's cured. On the flip side, platinum cured silicones have a much longer library life, they have really low toxicity, and low shrinkage over time. The drawback is that platinum cured silicones react a lot more to the sulfur in the object that's being molded. And by react, I mean that the silicone won't fully cure and you'll end up with a really gooey mess. There are a lot of common objects that you may try to use in your casting and molding process that have sulfur in them and you may not realize it. Most common modeling clays that you may use to make something have sulfur inside them. Most resin prints from 3D printers or epoxy resins that you've used have sulfur. Also latex, so you shouldn't use latex gloves to mix up your platinum cured silicones. Next up, let's talk about vacuum chambers and pressure pots. Now, these are two things that you'll see people use a whole lot when making silicones or resins, and they have a really different purpose. Typically, you would use a pressure pot for materials that end up being hard, and a vacuum chamber for objects that end up being soft, like silicones or rubbers. A vacuum chamber creates a negative pressure. Basically, it pulls all the oxygen out of the chamber and expands any air that's left in there, popping bubbles inside the silicone. But on the opposite side, you have a pressure pot, which creates a positive pressure inside and compresses the air bubbles down to where you can't see them. But don't worry, there are a lot of silicones that don't require degassing of any kind. Oftentimes, the lower the shore hardness, the thinner the material, and that makes it easier to pour without getting bubbles into your silicone. But there are some techniques you can do when pouring your silicone to reduce the amount of bubbles as well. If you pour silicone from a really thin stream and make sure not to move it around a lot, you're not going to be introducing new bubbles into your pour. And another option is to paint on a really thin coat of silicone onto the object that you're molding to make sure that there are no bubbles on the surface. Then you can pour on top of that once it's cured. Once you start mixing together the two parts of your silicone, you're going to be working against the clock. You've started a chemical reaction that's going to happen in a fixed amount of time, and you need to make sure that you're prepared for it. There's two main times that you need to worry about. You've got the cure time and the pot life. Now, the cure time is obviously how long it takes for the silicone to fully cure. The pot life is how long you've got before that curing process begins and your rubber starts to harden. So basically, you want to mix it up, get it fully degassed, and then start your process of pouring before that pot life time that's indicated on the packaging. You also may see demold time on your packaging, and this is a time where it's safe to take your object out of the mold, but the silicone is not fully cured yet. This would be useful if you were trying to make multiple molds of the same object. You could actually take your object out of the mold before it's completely set up and make another one. Once you've mixed up your silicone, you'll often have parts left over in the containers. And just be aware that those do have a shelf life. Once you've opened a container, the shelf life of the material inside drops dramatically. You also need to consider the shelf life of your unopened material. Typically, unopened silicones will last from 9 to 12 months based on how they're stored. Now, the temperature that they're stored at has a lot to do with that. If you store your silicones at over 80 degrees, it will cut the shelf life down to 6 months. And if you store it at over 100 degrees, it goes down to 2 months. So it really matters how you store this material. And that's something to consider when you're buying it as well. Make sure that you're buying from a reputable source. So if you buy your material from a random seller on Amazon, you don't know how long it's been stored. By the time you get it in your shop and use it, you could be well past the shelf life of that particular material. Hopefully this video gave you some great information and will simplify the process of choosing a silicone. We've got a bunch of other Bits videos that you may want to check out, and we'll be back really soon with a new project. See you then.